Whether you have a car or a truck, on-road or off-road, if it's an electric vehicle, there's one component that your RC car or truck will have in common with any other RC vehicle that's out there, and that's that it uses some sort of an electric-powered motor. Whether you're dealing with a brushed or brushless motor system, sealed end bell, closed end bell, open end bell, sensored or sensorless brushless motor, there's a lot of different technology that goes into making your RC car or truck drive around for you. We're going to go through and we're going to spell out some of the different technologies that are out there, what some of the different components of the motors are, and what the benefits of each type of motor is. So let's get started. We have a number of different motors here on the bench, and we're going to start with this one here from ECX. You guys will probably recognize this as the 20-turn motor that comes with like the circuit, the boost, the ruckus, and the torment. This is what's referred to as a sealed end bell motor. The reason for that is you can't get inside the motor itself to do any sort of maintenance. You can't change the brushes on this, and we'll explain what brushes are in just a moment. You can't swap out any of the components. Basically, when this motor is done, you walk to the local trash can, drop it in, and buy a new one. That's basically the original type of electric motor that RC cars started out with. In years that followed, many manufacturers came out with a motor kind of like this. If you can see, it's shaped and configured quite a bit differently than a sealed or a closed end bell motor. The reason for this is this motor now allows you access to what are called the brushes. And the brushes are an integral component of any brushed motor. And again, we'll show you what that is in just a second. In addition to being able to change the brushes, you can also now change the springs on these. The different tensions that you use on the springs can change the performance of your motor. Also, as a motor gets hot, it'll actually reduce the tension that any spring may put out. Now, if we want to come a little bit closer, let's give you a closer look at some of the components that make up a brushed motor. So here again, just the Dynamite 20-turn motor, and we have a second one here that what I've done is I've opened it up. It's called popping the end bell, basically. And we're going to pull it apart so you can see the different components on this motor here. First of all, this very top cap here, this is called the end bell. And in the end bell itself, you have either a bushing or a bearing, which you can see this has an oil-like bushing here. And if you flip it over, you can see these two copper or brass-looking tabs, and then there's these little squares that are attached to it. These are basically the springs that apply tension to the brushes. And the brushes rub against this component here. This is called the commutator. And basically, this is what acts as a switch to turn the current on and off to energize the motor itself to provide propulsion, basically. Now, this entire component here is called an armature. And like I mentioned, there's a number of different components to it. This is called, again, the commutator. Some motors have a little plastic fan on the top of these three green pieces. These are called the stacks. And basically what this plastic piece here is, it's a fan to help keep the motor cool. Now, around here you can see all these copper wires. Every one of these, every time you make a turn around this stack, is quite honestly called a turn. The number of turns of wire determines how fast or slow a motor is and how much torque that it has as well. The fewer number of turns of wire that you have around this stack, the less resistance that you have in the motor. So basically, it's allowed to release its energy more easily. The lower the turn on the motor, generally speaking, the faster the motor will be. The higher the turn of the motor, the slower it will be. Finally, you just have a shim on the bottom of the armature itself, and then you have your output shaft on the bottom here that is, you can see the flat spot on here where you can go ahead and attach your pinion gear on. Now, that's how a sealed end bell motor goes together. Now, one thing of note here, once you pop the end bell like this, first of all, most tracks, if they're running a class that requires use of a sealed end bell motor, if you do this, you're disqualified. This is an illegal modification to a motor. We simply did this for demonstration purposes. The other thing is, these are very difficult to put back together and not have them fall apart. There's a number of tabs here around the motor that basically it's a press fit to keep the end bell on. If you pop those, you may not be able to get it back together. Now, in addition to the sealed end bell motor, I did want to take a second here and show you what an armature out of an open end bell motor would look like. This is out of an old Trinity motor, and as you can see here, it has a tag on there stating that it is an Epic 27 turn motor. This is what's called a stock motor. 27 turns, so 27 times the wire goes around each of these stacks. And as you can see, in comparison to the ECX motor, the stack is actually split here. What that does is it changes the way the armature interacts with the magnetic field inside the motor itself, changes the power band a little bit. There are some motors, like the ECX one, where it's a full stack, it's not cut out at all. There's ones like this that have the stacks, they're basically two separated stacks on each pole here. And then there's other ones that have three and four magnets too, all depending on what the motor manufacturer was trying to do. You can also see on this stack right here and on this stack here, these little holes that are drilled in it. Those holes are drilled in there by the manufacturer to balance the armature, to make sure that when it spins at high RPM that you don't get a whole lot of wobble out of it. It just makes the armature spin a little bit more truly. Now we're going to bring in our open end bell motor and give you a closer look here. Again, as you can see, the end bell is configured a little bit differently. It's almost as if you take a closed end bell motor and flip the end bell inside out. You have your bushing here on the very top. There's another one here on the bottom. And then you have these pieces right here, these openings. These are called brush hoods. And that's where these little guys here slide in and out. These are your brushes. And like I mentioned earlier, this is what actually transfers the electricity from your battery pack to the motor itself. You can get different compounds of brushes, different shapes, different sizes. You can alter the performance of the brush by drilling holes in it or slicing them up. We've done all sorts of silly things just to make more horsepower. There's a couple of different configurations on brushes. There's what's called a stand-up brush, and that's in this configuration that you see here. It's basically taller than it is wide. Some motor manufacturers, primarily in 19-turn and 27-turn stock motors, have also gone to what's called a lay-down configuration. It's the same physical brush size, but it's wider than it is tall. And the reason for this is, as the brush spins around the commutator, it changes each one of the slots you see here in the commutator itself. Basically, think of them as an on-off switch. As it goes around, this part of the commutator is on. Now you temporarily have two segments on at the same time as the brush overlaps that slot. And now this segment is off and this segment here would be energized. With the 27-turn stock motors and the 19-turn motors, some motor manufacturers, a majority of them, have found when you have more brush overlap between those two segments, the motors simply produce more power. In addition to more power, they also pit and groove the slots around the commutator here. You can see the grooves that have been worn in this motor. This is a motor that I've run in my on-road car before, and you can see the pits and grooves that are in there. When it gets to a certain point, you would have to do what's called turning the armature, where basically you strip material away using a comm lathe. We're not going to show you that here. Comm lathes really aren't used that much anymore now that brushed technology has kind of gone by the wayside, and brushless motors have pretty well taken over. But, as I mentioned, you can get different compounds of brushes, different shapes and different sizes, and depending on the brush and spring combination you go with, it can change the performance of your motor. The final thing here, just to show you real quick, is that, well, on this end of the motor here, and then on the end bell, the motors that we've shown you here have got bushings in them. There are other motors, most commonly referred to as modified motors, that this has a ball bearing in it. The difference between the bushing and the bearing is the bushing will wear out in time. Bearings will spin a whole lot more freely, and the bushings will have more rolling resistance to them. The other thing to remember is, let's imagine that we had a pinion gear on here right now. As the gears mesh with each other, and let's imagine we have a spur gear here. So we have our spur gear here, the motor's turning the pinion on this side. As they mesh, just the forces between the pinion and the spur gear is going to try to push the output shaft on the motor away from it. Well, a bushing will eventually become ovaled out a little bit on the side where the armature is being pushed. With the ball bearing, because it's a more rigid race that the armature is riding on, you don't have that issue. So that's one of the benefits of a bearing over a bushing. So now, in addition to the different types of brush motors that are out there, we have brush motors like this 20 turn from Dynamite right here. We also have brushless motors such as this one here from Dynamite. And a lot of people ask, what are the differences between a brushed and a brushless motor? The easiest way to think of it is, with a brushless motor, there's really no wear and tear anywhere on the motor. There's no brushes to wear out, there's no bushings to wear out. They're fairly maintenance free. They develop more power, but generally speaking, produce fewer RPMs. On a brush motor, they're cheaper to produce. That's why you see them included in a lot of ready to run vehicles. They're, you know, on at least the sealed end bell stuff, there's not a whole lot of maintenance. You'll have to occasionally oil the bushings and clean it out from time to time. But if you happen to have an issue where a brush motor wears out or dies on you, for relatively low cost, you can replace that brush motor with another one and keep using all the same electronics. With a brushless motor system, you do have to use a completely different electronic speed controller than what you did with a brushed. One of the reasons, if you notice, our brush motor here just has two wires, a red for positive and a black for negative. On our brushless, we have three. The reason behind this, and I talked to Charlie Swanka from Novak Electronics on this, the reason why we have three wires here versus two is, just to keep it in simple terms, a brushless motor runs on a form of AC, or alternating current, where the brush motor works off of DC, or direct current. There's a lot more switching that goes on here with the different phases of the stator as it gets energized throughout the rotation of the armature in there, where you don't have all that going on here with the brush motor. In addition to brushed versus brushless, we also have sensorless versus sensored. And from the outside, they look identical. I'll give you that. You can't tell, for the most part, you can't tell a sensorless motor from a sensored. The giveaway is this little port right here. What this is there's an extra cable that goes from this port to your electronic speed controller, and that allows the electronic speed controller to monitor the position of the rotor in the motor just to ensure smoother power delivery. This is mostly important when you're initially, you know, when you just punch the throttle when you're first taking off. Once you're up in the RPM range, it really doesn't matter that much. So some of the differences between a sensored and a sensorless motor are, again, you have that sensor wire first of all. A sensored motor is going to actually be a little bit more expensive along with a sensored speed controller. The other thing is, on sensored motors, you can also adjust the timing of the motor. That'll increase or decrease the RPM range. It changes the power band a little bit too. But what some manufacturers, such as Trinity here, have done is they've also introduced motors that you cannot adjust the timing on. Why would you do this? Well, this makes for a more spec level racing. With a motor that you can't adjust the timing on, you throw it in the car and you go. You don't have to adjust the timing. Once you find your gearing, you're done. And a lot of tracks, in addition to going with a fixed timing motor, have also gone to rules on speed controllers where you can't adjust any of the parameters such as timing and boost. Other than that, performance from one to the other, you can generally get better performance for the money out of a sensorless system than sensored. You're looking about $20 to $30 less generally for a sensorless motor than sensored. But you just don't have that feel as you're gripping the throttle and getting on the power as you're getting ready to go. For me personally, I prefer the feel of a sensored motor system. But it's also because this also closely mimics the performance and the feel of a brushed motor too. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take a couple different brushless motors apart and give you a look inside the motors of both sensored 540 and sensored 550 motors. We have a Thunder Power 17 5-turn motor here, and if you look at it, the armature has now become your magnet, and this is called your rotor, and your can has become the armature, so to speak, because the windings are all in here, and this is called your stator. What you can really do too, which is kind of neat, is say that you buy, in this case we have a 17.5, say you wanted to run a 13.5 motor. Well, all that you have to do is replace the stator with a 13.5 stator and drop in the rest of your components and you're good to go. This again is basically just a big magnet. And as the stator, the different poles of the stator get electrified, it will shift position for, you know, in relation to the rotor itself, causing it to rotate. The bottom of the, really this is just a sleeve that goes over the can itself, but that also houses the ball bearing on the bottom. And this is the closest thing to an end bell that you'll find on a brushless motor, just because it goes on the end of the motor. On this motor here, you can see you can actually adjust the timing, which will make the motor faster or slower, develop more torque or more RPM, depending on its position. As you can see here, I think I have this one set to about 35 degrees of timing. Now, this is a standard 540 sized brushless motor. In some of the four-wheel drive short course trucks, they've opted to go with a larger motor called a 550. And I'm gonna bring in a motor here from Novak. As you can see here, comparing the size and the length of the stators here side by side, the 540 and the 550 are roughly the same diameter, but the 550 is significantly longer. This helps provide more torque to the motor itself. The other thing that it does, I'm going to move the stators aside. This is the 540 rotor that we just had out. This is the 550 rotor, and as you can see, these are really powerful magnets. You have a lot more material here too, again, to develop more torque. The reason behind this, these are generally used in larger, heavier vehicles, like the four-wheel drive short course trucks. Those are heavier trucks moving four wheels throughout their entire range of motion. You need the additional torque a 550 provides in most instances, as a 540, a traditional 540 motor, does not have the torque or the life to be able to withstand that abuse run after run. It's kind of neat. As I'm moving this one up and down, I'm feeling the pull on this one. It's just to play with the magnetic field is kind of neat on here. Also on the 550, like the 540, you can have adjustable timing. Novak does it a little bit differently, where there's three screws here, and then you can rotate the end bell. And again, you have a very large bearing at the bottom of the can to go ahead and support the rotor itself. Just like the Thunder Power, just has your sleeve that goes on there and everything goes right back together. Electric motors are just a blast to play around with, especially if you're like me and a gearhead. I've spent nights upon nights upon nights just working and tweaking on my motors, trying to get the best performance out of them. It's a puzzle that you have to work with, and there's a lot of different information out there, whether you're talking about brush motors or brushless. I hope I've helped answer at least some of your questions on each of these different motor types and made your life a little bit easier when it comes to this very confusing technology. If you do have any comments or questions about anything that you've seen here today or anything RC in general, feel free to email us at editors@horizonrc.com. Thanks for watching. We'll see you soon.